Ayodhya was a magnificent city on the banks of the river Saraya. The people of the city lived a happy and contented life as they were ruled by a wonderful king called Dasharatha. King Dasharatha had three wives, Kaushalya, Sumitra and Kaikeyi. But he was an unhappy man, for he was old and did not have any children. Being upset to see his sadness, the sages advised him to undertake a yajna and pray for children. Heeding to their advice, he performed the Putra Kameshti yajna. During the ritual, a magical form appeared out of the holy fire and offered divine sweetened milk to Dasharatha and told him to distribute it among his wives. Dasharatha was delighted. He thanked God for this boon and he divided the kheer among his wives. The kheer did its magic. Four lovely sons were born to Dasharatha. Kaushalya gave birth to Rama, Kaikeyi to Bharat, and Sumitra to Lakshmana and Shatrughna. King Dasharatha was very happy. The princes grew up as individuals with good qualities. They excelled themselves in archery, reading and hunting. They also learnt about the holy books and learnt how to look after the welfare of the people. They respected their gurus and the elders and gained the love and affection of the people of Ayodhya. One day, the great sage Vishwamitra came to Ayodhya. He was received with a warm welcome. Sage Vishwamitra asked King Dasharatha to send Rama along with him to protect him from the powerful demons which were disturbing his sacrifice. King Dasharatha was taken aback by the words of Vishwamitra. Rama was dearer to him than anything else in the world. But he could not refuse the great sage Vishwamitra. So he agreed to send Rama with him. With the blessings of Dasharatha, Rama and Lakshmana followed Vishwamitra to the forest. They went into Dandaka forest. A Rakshasi called Tataka lived here with her son Maricha. She had the strength of 1,000 elephants. She enchanted and cast spells. No one dared to enter the forest for fear of her. Vishwamitra told Rama to kill her. Rama pierced her heart with a deadly arrow. Tataka crashed to the earth. Vishwamitra rejoiced at Rama's great skill. He decided to give Rama and Lakshmana the divine weapons he had acquired through his austerities. Then the three went on towards Siddhashrama, which was the ashram of Vishwamitra. The hermits requested Rama to guard the sacrifice. They were afraid that the huge demons Maricha and Subahu could disturb the sacrifice. Vishwamitra took the vows of silence and started an elaborate sacrifice. Rama and Lakshmana guarded the place day and night. On the seventh day, when the sacrifice was nearly ending, a terrible noise was heard. Rama looked up and saw Maricha and Subahu. Rama silently prayed and discharged the newly acquired divine weapon. With one arrow, he hurled Maricha miles away into the sea. With another, he killed Subahu. Vishwamitra completed the sacrifice. The sages rejoiced and blessed the prince. Vishwamitra and the princess then proceeded to Mithila. This city was ruled by King Janaka. He had a daughter named Sita. King Janaka had declared that whoever managed to lift the divine Rudra's bow and string it would get his daughter Sita's hand in marriage. The bow was brought on an 8-wheeled chariot. Many strong warriors had tried lifting the bow, but failed. Vishwamitra asked Rama to lift the bow. Rama lifted the bow with ease. Placing one end against his toe, he put forth his might and bent the bow to string it, when the bow broke into two parts. King Janaka was speechless with joy. He blessed Rama and announced in the court that his beautiful daughter Sita would wed the brave prince. King Janaka sent messengers to Ayodhya to convey the happy news to King Dasharatha and to invite him for the wedding of their children. King Dasharatha was delighted to hear this news and reached Mithila along with his wives, his ministers, Sage Vasishta and others to take part in the wedding. Janaka arranged for a grand wedding. Rama married Sita. At the same time, Lakshmana married Sita's sister Urmila. Bharata and Shatrughna married Sita's cousins Mandavi and Srutakriti. A grand feast had been arranged for all the citizens. The newly wed couples were blessed by one and all. Dasharatha returned to Ayodhya with his sons and daughters-in-law. King Dasharatha was growing older, so he wanted to crown Rama as the king. Dasharatha therefore consulted his ministers about this. They unanimously welcomed the suggestion. But there was one woman who grieved to hear about Rama's coronation. It was Mantara. She was Kaikeyi's maidservant. She resolved to stop the coronation somehow or the other. She was the first to give the news of the coronation to Kaikeyi. At first, Kaikeyi was overjoyed to hear that Rama was to become the king. She loved Rama very much. But Mantara poisoned her mind. She told Kaikeyi that if Rama became the king, then he would make Bharata his servant and Kaikeyi would be nothing more than a glorified maid of Queen Kaushalya. Queen Kaikeyi, who loved Rama very much, now stood in fear of her own position. Her mind was poisoned. Kaikeyi and Mantara hatched an evil plan. Dasharatha went to Kaikeyi's apartments to convey personally the glad news of Rama's coronation. But what a strange sight met his eyes. Kaikeyi had thrown away all her ornaments. He asked her what the matter was. Kaikeyi recalled the day when she had saved the life of Dasharatha from the demons in a fierce battle. At that time, Dasharatha had promised two boons to her, which she could ask of him any time. And she wanted them now. The first boon was to crown Bharata as the crown prince, and the second one to send Rama to the forest for 14 years. Dasharatha could hardly believe his ears. He turned pale and speechless. He pleaded with Kaikeyi to ask for anything else, but she wouldn't change. Slowly it sank into Dasharatha that he would have to oblige Kaikeyi with her two boons. Soon Rama was summoned into Kaikeyi's chamber. and she told Rama everything about her wounds. Rama listened to her patiently. Rama believed that it was more important to obey a mother's wish and honor a father's commitment than anything else. So he agreed to go to the forest. As Rama prepared to leave for the forest, Sita pleaded with him to take her along, because she could not live without him. Rama permitted her to follow him. Even Lakshmana insisted on going with them. He did not wish to live in Ayodhya without Rama. Rama hesitated, for there was a very strong bond of love and affection between the two of them. At last, Rama permitted Lakshmana to accompany him. Rama, Sita and Lakshmana took the blessings of their parents and elders. As they prepared to leave, they sat in a chariot dressed like hermits. Dasharatha was thinking of Rama the whole night. He was unable to bear the agony of separation and passed into eternal bliss. Messengers were sent to Kekaya to bring Bharata and Shatrughna back. Bharata was shocked to see the entire city of Ayodhya in gloom. He rushed to the palace to find out what was happening. When Bharata found out about the wicked plans of his mother and her maid Mantara, he was disgusted. He cried at the loss of his father. He cried that Rama was exiled because of his mother. Bharata never wanted to be a king. Kaikeyi now knew how great her mistake was. Bharata made up his mind to go in search of Rama. He left Ayodhya with a large army and entered the forest. Kaikeyi and the other queens also followed him. On the other side, Rama, Lakshmana and Sita crossed the river Ganges, searching for a land undisturbed and isolated from everyone. Soon they reached Chitrakoot, a beautiful place with many trees and streams. They built a small hut near a stream and lived there. Bharata and his army approached Chitrakoot. As soon as Bharata saw Rama, he ran towards him and fell at his feet. Shatrughna also offered his salutations to Rama. Bharata broke the news of their father's death. Rama was shocked to hear it. Bharata pleaded with Rama to come back and rule Ayodhya. But Rama refused, saying that the death of Dasharatha would be meaningless if he were to come back to Ayodhya. He asked Bharata to go back and rule Ayodhya wisely. But Bharata was equally stubborn. He did not want to go back without Rama. At last, it was agreed that Bharata would rule as Rama's representative for the next 14 years. Bharata took Rama's sandals and carried them back to Ayodhya on his head with great respect. After Bharata's departure, Rama did not wish to live in Chitrakoot anymore. They left the forests of Chitrakoot and started their journey to the forests of Dandaka. The forests of Dandaka were dark and deep. Then they traveled to the south of the Vindhyas and visited the abode of the divine sage Agastya. Sage Agastya advised Rama to settle at Panchavati on the banks of the river Godavari. On reaching Panchavati, Lakshmana put up an elegant hut. It was here that they met the vulture king Jatayu. Jatayu was a friend of Dasharatha and wanted to help Rama in whatever way it could. In these forests, unknown to the brothers, an ugly demoness had been watching Rama and fell in love with him. She was Surpanaka. She was the sister of the mighty emperor Ravana. She approached Rama and introduced herself. She asked Rama to leave Sita and come with her. Sensing that Rama was not interested in her, the demon grew angry. She tried to attack Sita, but Lakshmana quickly drew out his sword and cut off her ears and nose. Surpanaka, crying with pain, ran away into the forest to seek the help of her brothers. She asked Kara and Dushana to avenge the insult heaped on her by two humans. Kara, who was infuriated on seeing the condition of his dear sister, ordered his army to march against Rama. Rama fought against them, while Lakshmana stood guard near Sita. Rama destroyed the entire army and soon killed Kara and Dushana too. Surpanaka watched in horror as her brothers and their army were destroyed. She flew at once to Lanka to seek the protection of Ravana. Ravana was shocked to see his sister disfigured. He asked her for the cause. Surpanaka narrated everything about Rama and Lakshmana, and she also told Ravana that Sita was very beautiful. Ravana thought of a plan that would get the lovely Sita. Ravana flew in his Pushpaka Vimana. He reached the home of Maricha, Tataka's son. He asked the demon Maricha, the master of disguise, to take the form of a golden deer. Maricha, who had already been punished by Rama once, refused at first. But Maricha knew that either way he would be killed. He preferred to die at Rama's hands and so agreed to Ravana's plan. Maricha turned himself into a golden deer and roamed in front of Sita's hut. She asked Rama to catch it for her. Rama asked Lakshmana to look after Sita and he went behind the deer. The deer led him deep into the forest, always a little out of reach. At last, when Rama found it impossible to catch it alive, he killed it with a sharp arrow. As the arrow hit, Maricha gained his true form and screamed in a voice imitating Rama. He called for help to Sita and Lakshmana. Ravana's plan had worked. Thinking that some trouble had befallen Rama, Sita insisted that Lakshmana must go and help his brother. So Lakshmana decided to go. But before he left, he drew a circle around the entrance to the hut and told Sita not to cross the circle at any cost till he returned. Ravana saw how well his trick had worked. Sita was alone. He disguised himself as a hermit and approached Sita with a begging bowl. Seeing a holy man, Sita brought some food and offered it to him, standing within the line drawn by Lakshmana. Ravana asked her to come out of the line to make the offering. And before she realized what she was doing, Ravana caught hold of her hands and placed her in his chariot. Sita screamed, but it was too late. The chariot rose into the sky and sped off to Lanka. As Ravana headed south, Jatayu, the great eagle, saw Sita. He came swooping down on Ravana and fought with him. Ravana mercilessly cut off Jatayu's wings as he sped away like a flash of lightning on his chariot, dragging Sita with him. All the efforts of Sita to escape proved in vain as Ravana overpowered her. As they flew over mountains and forests, Sita took off her jewelry one by one and threw it down, hoping that Rama might see it. As they landed in Lanka, Ravana asked Sita to become his wife. When Sita refused him, he left her in the palace garden in the company of ugly she-demons. Sita was scared, sad and lonely in the strange place. Meanwhile, in the forest of Panchavati, Rama and Lakshmana realized that they had been tricked. Only through the dying Eagle King Jatayu did they come to know that Ravana had abducted Sita. They prayed for the noble soul of Jatayu, who had sacrificed his own life for them. Rama and Lakshmana now wandered in search of Sita. Rama and Lakshmana soon reached Rishyamukha. It was a hilly region where many Vanaras lived. Sugreeva was their leader. He had the assistance and friendship of Hanuman, a valiant and highly intelligent Vanara. Hanuman introduced himself to the two brothers as the minister of the Vanara King Sugreeva. He inquired about who Rama and Lakshmana were and what they were doing in the forest. Rama told Hanuman about Ayodhya, his exile, and the abduction of Sita. Hanuman took Rama and Lakshmana to Sugreeva. They told their story to him. Sugreeva made an offer to Rama that if Rama were to help him to get rid of Vali, then Sugreeva would summon the entire monkey and bear clans to help Rama find Sita. Rama, seeing that injustice was done to Sugreeva by Vali, agreed. In a fierce duel between Vali and Sugreeva, Rama shot dead Vali with his arrow. Sugreeva took over the reins of Kishkinda. Thus, with the help of the entire Vanara clan, the search for Sita began. Fierce Vanara warriors went north, south, east and west. The troops that went south were led by the trusted Hanuman. Searching thoroughly and unable to find Sita, they finally reached the seashore. They wondered where to look for her now. Jatayu's brother, the aged Sampati, also came to hear of the whole story through the Vanaras. He felt sad that Jatayu had been killed by Ravana. Although he could not fly, he still had the sharp sight of a vulture. He could see into the distance, and he was the one to see Sita far across the ocean, all alone and sad in the island of Lanka. The Vanaras felt happy that at least they knew where Sita was. But they wondered how they could cross the vast ocean and reach Lanka. Hanuman prayed to Rama. Soon Hanuman was growing in size and became so big that the hills turned into tiny stones under his feet. Then, thinking of his mission to find Sita, Hanuman pressed his foot hard into the ground and leaped high into the air. He was soon flying over the ocean. Finally, he landed on the glistening shores of Lanka. Once in Lanka, he set out to find Sita. Hanuman entered the Ashoka garden. Beneath one of the trees was the most beautiful woman Hanuman had ever seen. She was Sita. Sita was surrounded by many she-demons. Hanuman waited for all the demons to sleep as he approached Sita. Sita's heart was filled with gladness as he presented her with Rama's ring and told her that he was the messenger of Rama. Hanuman narrated the entire story of how Rama met Sugreeva and their search for Sita. Sita gave Hanuman a jewel that she wore, which Rama would recognize. She blessed Hanuman as he prepared to leave. Suddenly, the demons awoke. When Ravana heard about the destruction caused by a monkey, he sent his son Indrajit to capture the monkey. Indrajit was a very skilled warrior. He used one of his powerful weapons on Hanuman, imprisoned him, and dragged him to Ravana's court. When Hanuman was brought before the king, he was very impressed with the ten-headed Ravana. Hanuman then warned Ravana about the danger which he would be facing if he did not return Sita to Rama and ask for forgiveness. Ravana became wild with rage. He ordered that Hanuman should be put to death at once. But Vibheeshana, his younger brother, intervened and pointed out that it would be improper to kill a messenger. Then Ravana ordered Hanuman's tail to be set on fire. The king's men wrapped Hanuman's tail in cloth and set fire to it. With his long tail on fire, Hanuman flew into the sky. He decided to set the city of Lanka ablaze to punish Ravana. He flew low over the city and set each building, palace, and garden on fire. Flames shot high into the sky. Then he finally jumped into the ocean to put off the fire on his tail. Hanuman reached Kishkinda and told Rama all about Sita's safety. Rama was overjoyed when he saw the jewel that Hanuman had brought back. Meanwhile, in Lanka, Ravana refused to listen to the wise counsel of his younger brother Vibheeshana. Vibheeshana knew that if war broke out, it would mean the end of the demon race. But Vibheeshana's words hurt Ravana's ego, and he accused Vibheeshana of being a traitor. Hurt by this, Vibheeshana went to Rama and sought refuge under him. Sri Rama accepted Vibheeshana and promised him that upon Ravana's death, he would be the king of Lanka. Vibheeshana asks Rama to pray to the sea god to build a bridge across the ocean. Rama prays for a whole day, but there is no response from the sea god. Rama gets dejected. He gets angry and gets ready to attack the ocean. Then suddenly the sea god emerges and asks Rama to build the bridge over the sea. The Vanaras build a bridge across the sea by placing stones, trees, and sand. The bridge was ready in 5 days. Cheering with excitement, the Vanara army crossed the sea and reached Lanka. Ravana sent many more demons who were very good at warfare. A fierce battle broke out between the Vanaras and demons. Each one of the Vanaras fought bravely and injured or killed many demons. The demons fought equally well. Ravana felt very humiliated. Ravana now woke up the sleeping giant Kumbhakarna. He was Ravana's brother. He ate for 6 months and slept for 6 months. Ravana knew that only he could save Lanka from ruin. When Kumbhakarna came to know that he was woken up because of the war, he walked towards the battlefield. He was very huge and massive. The Vanaras were terrified of his size and form. They were no match for him. After seeing the panic in the Vanaras, Rama rose to face Kumbhakarna. A fierce battle was waged. Rama used one of his powerful weapons and chopped Kumbhakarna's arms and legs. Kumbhakarna died. The Vanaras felt very happy at this success. Ravana was shocked to hear about his brother's death. As his last hope, he called his son Indrajit. Indrajit possessed immense magical powers. Indrajit returned to the battle. Finally, Indrajit discharged the sacred Brahmastra and Lakshmana lay unconscious on the battlefield. Rama and the monkey army felt sad on seeing Lakshmana like this. Jambavan, on seeing this happen, took control of the situation and summoned Hanuman. He told him to go to the Himalayas to the Sanjeevani Parvata and bring back 4 wonderful herbs, which had healing qualities, to rescue everyone. Hanuman rose above the earth and flew off with great speed. When he reached the Himalayas, he saw the mountain that Jambavan had described. But he could not find the herbs. So he uprooted the entire mountain with all the herbs growing there and returned to Lanka. The fragrance of the herbs in the mountain revived Lakshmana. The battle was resumed. Lakshmana used the Indrastra, and the great warrior Indrajit fell dead. With the fall of Indrajit, Ravana was shattered. He wailed most piteously, and his sorrow gave place to anger. He started for the battlefield. Ravana came face to face with Rama. Both Ravana and Rama were equally powerful. The battle between them was very fierce. One by one, Rama cut off Ravana's 10 heads with his arrows. But no sooner was one head cut off than another grew to take its place. Finally, Rama used a very powerful weapon, which was the mightiest of all mighty weapons. The weapon whizzed through the air, emitting flame. It pierced the chest of Ravana. Ravana fell back dead from his chariot. Ravana had lost everything due to his greed and lust. After Ravana's death, Vibheeshana was duly crowned the king of Lanka. Sita's eyes sparkled with tears of joy as she was once again united with her husband Rama. The 14 years of exile was almost over. Rama, Lakshmana, Sita, Hanuman and Sugreeva mounted the Pushpaka Vimana and bade farewell to Lanka. The Pushpaka Vimana reached Ayodhya. Bharata was waiting for Rama's return. Soon Rama was crowned the king of Ayodhya. Hanuman had become an ardent devotee of Rama. He sat at Rama's feet. Sri Rama ruled over Ayodhya for many years. People lived a happy, contented life in his kingdom, And this glorious reign was hailed as Ramarajya. Jai Shri Ram.